John the Baptist baptized and preached along the River Jordan, possibly in the same area where the Israelites entered the Promised Land. John was compelled to prepare the way for the coming of the Messiah. And when the Messiah arrived, he pointed to him, and then he withdrew, believing that he had accomplished his task. This is the Rhine River. It is much wider than the Jordan River. And just as the Jordan River creates a natural border between Israel and the Kingdom of Jordan, so does the Rhine River create a natural border between Switzerland and Germany. Obviously, the Swiss are here, the Germans are there. The people on both sides of this river share very similar customs and lifestyles. Interesting. Many of the families that settled throughout this area bear the name Jordan.
By the middle of the 19th century, this land belonged to the Grand Duchy of Baden. Soon it was incorporated into the German Empire. The southern part of this land, shaped by hills and valleys, crossed by streams and rivers running down from the slopes of Schwarzwald towards the River Rhine, is named Breisgau. Numerous settlements naturally blending into the landscape form an integral part of the dominant surroundings. In ancient times, Breisgau was part of the border region of the Roman Empire. Thanks to this, Christianity had already arrived here in the 4th century. Among many picturesque settlements in the region, one of them particularly draws our attention. Gutweil appears in historical records as early as the 9th century. However, the discovery of foundations of stone buildings indicate that this area was inhabited by Roman legionaries several centuries earlier. Two structures are significant in the settlement of Gutweil. The 17th century building known as the castle, which once belonged to the Benedictine Abbey of Saint Blaise, and today is occupied by Caritas. And the 17th century Baroque church, set up in place of an older temple built several decades earlier. The interior of today's church is restored in Rococo, late Baroque style. The apostles Jude, Thaddeus, and Simon were chosen as the patron saints.
There is a place in this church that is of particular interest to us. This is a relief of Father Francis Mary of the Cross Jordan, the founder of the Society of the Divine Savior, also known as the Salvatorians. He receives his first sacrament at this font and is baptized with the name John Baptist. And this is his story.
When John was 12, a census was conducted in the area. We learn that Gutweil numbered 460 people, 97% of whom were Catholic. The inhabitants of the village were mostly farmers, but there were also blacksmiths, coopers, shoemakers, carpenters, bricklayers, and even watchmakers. The mid-19th century political turmoil, such as the rise of the nation-states, somehow echoed in this area. But knowledge and understanding of worldly events were rather limited.
The Jordan family has been present in Gertweil for several generations. The grandfather of John Baptist is Francis Jordan. He becomes a widower after only 5 years of marriage. He remarries for a second time, and five children are born out of this marriage. The oldest son, Lawrence, is the father of John Baptist. Grandfather Francis is quite involved in the community. He's a day worker, farmer, local community judge, and an assistant in the church. Unfortunately, Grandfather Francis does not have much luck with business matters. He invests financially in the construction of a road along the Schluss River. This investment proves to be a failure, and it creates a very serious debt for the Jordan family. This leads to the selling of the family property, the family home, and the adjacent land. Half the amount they receive is used to pay off the debt. The other half is used to purchase a rather modest family home. Lawrence, as the eldest son, takes over the house, and with it, the debts of his father. Together with his sisters and brothers, they are continuously affected by unsuccessful investments. Lawrence finds himself working long hours as a servant in a hostel. There, he meets Nordberger. They both fall in love and soon choose to live together. And within a few years, they decide to marry, now that the debts are settled. They come to the altar in early June 1848. 1 week later, second son is born. They name him John Baptist.
John had two brothers. Martin was 5 years older. As a young man, he took part in the war between Prussia and Austria. Then he settled in Gertweil and started his own family. Edward, the younger brother, was a fisherman at first. Later, he made a lot of money investing in road construction. He also lived with his family in Gertweil until the end of his days. As young boys, the three brothers shared the common fate of the Jordan family, marked by poor living conditions and limited opportunity. Their house was described as follows. The Jordan family had a poor apartment with a roof of straw almost to the ground, without walls, without a chimney. John Baptist and his two brothers had the poorest room under the roof without a real window.
John knows what it's like to be poor at an early age, but it cultivates his imagination and it moves him to become more compassionate. It also strengthens him to overcome obstacles and teaches him the value of working hard to reach his goals. There are several mills, like this one, in the vicinity of Gerdweil. But this mill is very special to John. It is located just opposite the Jordan family home. It belongs to Valentin Meyer, a simple, honest, and kind neighbor.
Mr. Meyer has many religious books, including the various lives of the saints. His collection is a real treasure in such a poor environment. John Baptist visits the mill frequently, and he absorbs the stories page by page. They not only expand his imagination, but they inspire him to live for something greater. The stories of the saints especially ignite a fire in his heart that will continue to burn with zeal throughout his life.
Edward, the youngest of the Jordan brothers, would say about John that he was the brightest student in school. In fact, this is the very classroom where he studied. And what he would do is go up to the blackboard and draw a caricature of a person or something comical and evoke laughter from the students and even the teachers. Someone observed him and he said, he gazes out the window sometimes and it's like he's daydreaming. Apparently he had a very active imagination and fantasy life. And then he would bring in creatures into the classroom, like a bumblebee or even a snake. Father Kessler sums him up when he addresses him directly and says, John, you are either going to be a very good and very brave man or a very bad one. The time of carefree jokes and lightness of being soon come to an end for John. Two profound experiences speed up his maturation process and his sense of responsibility and duty in life. Lawrence, John's father, works in this little town, Reinheim, as a helper right here in Angel's Inn. He earns some money to support his family and pay his debts, but clearly it's not sufficient income. So he asks for additional work, assisting with the horses. The Rhine River is less than 400 feet from the inn. On the other side of the river, in Switzerland, is the town Sırtsak. A marketplace is there for the farmers and the merchants of the area, but for many of them, it is far more convenient to park their horse and carriage at the inn, and then simply walk across the bridge to the marketplace. Lawrence enjoys working with the horses. One day, there are over 50 horses on the grounds of the inn. Well, he's trying to manage this chaotic scene, but the horses become very anxious. And the next thing he knows, he is underneath the hooves of a stomping horse. He barely escapes with his life. His leg is crushed, and there's serious injuries to his chest. Lawrence now struggles to function effectively. The local blacksmith creates a brace for his leg, but his chest never really heals. All this limits his capacity to work and earn a living for his family. So now much more responsibility falls on his sons, Martin, John, and Edward. This whole situation causes the 7-year-old John to take on more tasks and chores at home. His father, Lawrence, dies a few years after the accident. The absence of his father is very painful for him. But fortunately, John doesn't become resentful or rebellious. But in fact, this contributes to the development of his spiritual life. Something awakens in him. And now John prays often, be it in the forest or in some secluded area. A few years earlier, another event adds to the transformation and the fate of John. Almost 13 years old, John Baptist receives his first Holy Communion. This fact alone is not something extraordinary. In such a Catholic culture, it's the natural order of things. During the ceremony, he draws attention by his unruly behavior. He looks like he's distracted by something. After Mass, the parish priest, Father Kessler, punishes him severely. And John tried to explain that something like a white pigeon was flying around his head and he couldn't help it. Well, the priest was surprised. And from that moment on, he paid special attention to this young Jordan. That quite strange experience that happened at his first communion, along with the death of his father, Lawrence, seems to have opened up a spiritual dimension deep within him. And he becomes much more serious about his life. Life goes on as usual for John Baptist. After completing elementary school, he really wants to continue his education. But given his family's financial situation, he's forced to look for work wherever he can find it. So at the age of 14, he joins many residents of Gurtweil on the construction of the railway leading to Konstanz. It's hard work, but it pays really well.
When at home in the evening, John reads intently, and he also develops his talent for painting. Despite his daily hardships, there is one hope and desire that keeps getting clearer and clearer. And for now, he knows he can't find a way to attain it, especially because of financial limitations and challenges. But by the age of 18, he already knows that God has something special for him. And there's no turning back. There's this inner conviction that's growing stronger. And John knows that he needs to trust, to persevere, and be disciplined so he can move forward.
The desires of a young man are usually equal to his belief that everything in life is possible. All obstacles appear temporary, and reaching ambitious goals is just a matter of time. Of course, over time, struggles, mistakes, and failures raise the awareness of limitations. Sometimes it leads to a change of direction in life and the putting aside of what once seemed to be the best option. But that which genuinely comes from within and what is commonly called vocation will constantly seek ways of coming to fruition in all circumstances. In the middle of the 19th century, to become a priest was quite a difficult and long process, especially when it started in a small village in a poor family. It was not easy to get onto the road leading to the sacrament of holy orders.
John's talent for painting is revealed early in elementary school. He often paints people he knows. Also, he creates two serious pieces. One, the crucifixion of Jesus. And the second is a charcoal rendering of the Madonna and the baby Jesus. Probably influenced by the ceiling painting just above us here in Gertva. Now, amateur painting is not enough. Professional training is needed, along with trade skills. So at 16 years old, John goes to the nearby town of Waldshut. John Baptist begins his apprenticeship as a painter with the master Hildenbrand. He is a diligent student, and apart from painting, he develops the skills to become an upholsterer and a goldsmith. Oh, by the way, this is the very path that he walks every day from Gutweil to his workshop in Waldshut, passing this charming Calvary chapel. At the end of his apprenticeship, he receives written praise for his fidelity, urgency, and moral stance. The 19-year-old is now ready to go out into the world and leave his native land.
John Baptist left the family home in March of 1867. First, he worked in Augsburg, Regensburg, and then Baden-Baden. Later also in Hamburg, Berlin, and in the Czech lands. The big cities were quite different to small Gottwald. They offered many opportunities and attractions. A liberal lifestyle was more prevalent in the culture of those days, but John lived rather modestly. Most of his free time was spent studying foreign languages. The world outside the family environment was full of temptations. Everything could have happened otherwise, but the journey ended in August of the following year. His passport, which was necessary for travel, had expired. In addition, obligatory military service was looming.
Every 20-year-old man must serve in the military. It's the law. John Baptist is enlisted to serve in the 6th Infantry Regiment in Konstanz. However, after only 6 weeks, he is sent home. Why? It happens that some students and teachers are released along with Jordan. Perhaps it was more so because of his health condition. The Franco-Prussian War breaks out the following year. And again, Jordan is enlisted to serve and placed in Strasbourg. And again, he is sent home before leaving for the battlefield. This time it is perceived as a direct act of divine providence. This monument in Tingen commemorates all the inhabitants of the town who took part in this war. John returns to Gottwald and sternly says, "I need to continue my education." Upon hearing this, his mother replies, "You are a rascal. Nothing good will come of you." But her son's determination is unwavering, and he says, "This time, I am serious." Fortunately, John's local pastor, Father Gessler, senses his authenticity and sees potential. So he decides to help John. Father Gessler arranges with two other priests to give private lessons to John. As a student, John proves to be dedicated and disciplined. And though often he is tired and hungry, he doesn't give up. After completing the needed preparation, he's given a very good recommendation. And now he's ready for the next step. John begins his journey to Konstanz.
The location of the city is on the shore of the lake from which the River Rhine flows, continuing its course to the west. Around the year 40 AD, the Romans defeated the Celts in this area. Then they established a settlement. Later, they called it Konstanz, probably in honor of Emperor Constantius Chlorus. From the early Middle Ages, Konstanz was the center of the largest Catholic diocese north of the Alps, located on the trade route from Italy to Germany. The town quickly expanded and gained its reputation. In the 15th century, the General Council of the Roman Catholic Church began here, during which Pope Martin V was elected. It brought to an end the so-called Western Schism, the period when three popes simultaneously claimed to be the head of the Roman Catholic Church. In modern times, the city has lost some of its importance. In the middle of the 19th century, a railway station was built here, which contributed to the city's re-emergence.
A former Jesuit college in Constance now houses the Grand Duke College. John, after passing the entrance examination, is accepted into the sixth year of secondary school. He's now 22 years of age, and his classmates are a bit younger. But more so, there's quite a gap in his studies from when he first completed primary school. But this forces him to work hard to catch up. He particularly struggles with mathematics, but John doesn't give up. This impresses his classmates and colleagues, and some are surprised that he would return to study since he already has a profession and the skills to make a career out in the world. But John, the student, knows what he's about.
The years of John Baptist Jordan High School and the following of theological studies fell during the period in German history called Kulturkampf, a struggle for culture. Chancellor Otto von Bismarck tried to limit the influence of the church on social life. Many religious congregations were forbidden to act publicly. Seminaries were closed, and clerics had to pass a state exam if they wanted to perform pastoral functions. Church institutions also did not have the right to teach. All of this could easily have discouraged a young person from joining the priesthood.
While attending high school in Konstanz, John resides in various locations. Practically every year, it's a different place. One of the places is a Dominican convent, Zofingen, and they provide a small room upstairs. He also eats daily meals here, yet not only here. Poor students have fixed days where they can eat with different families in town. They're called students with a spoon. Why? Because they're students who carry spoon all the time to be ready to eat. John is not as destitute as some. He receives support from his younger brother, Edward, along with some other generous people. John is able to continue his studies until his final exam. At the beginning, it was not easy, but now John Baptist Jordan can celebrate. He is among 18 students who receive a high school certificate. The note on his diploma reads, "Taking into consideration that he started high school late, John made commendable progress due to his urgency and attentive attendance. However,
He would have completed his studies without difficulty if he devoted himself to all subjects instead of concentrating sometimes on useless, though beloved, areas of interest. He presented scientific linguistic works, the Sophocles Electra study in 8 European languages, and the elaboration of the love of the fatherland in 4 modern languages. It's easy to guess what attracts John the most in his studies. This focus will continue. The time in Constance comes to an end. Before taking his next step toward higher education, the new graduate goes on holidays with excitement as he travels to Rome. This is a key journey in John's life. During this time, the future founder visits Rome's historical sites. From a spiritual diary, we learn that his visit evokes strong emotions within him, especially while visiting the catacombs. This intensifies his desire to dedicate himself to Christ and to serve the church. But now, it is time to return and continue his education.